Procedure, we'll have an embargoed section to this. We're very busy today because I think it's the first time a lot of you have had a chance to speak to the boss. So we'll go two for Vinny, two for Steve Wyeth, and then we'll go through the broadcasters, probably one each unless there's desperation for a follow-up. Pretty much checking, I think that's ready to go. Vinny, you got the first two press conferences? First two questions of the press conference.
Oh, great.
Fire away, then.
Hi, Jürgen, again. First of all, Jürgen, obviously you've announced today that Virgil van Dijk has signed a new long-term contract. Can you just give us your reaction to that good news for the football club?
Yes, great news. The good thing about this signing is that we know him already, that we used him before already quite successfully, and we are really happy that he's happy here. And even more so after that obviously very difficult last year, that he is back on track, trains with the team, and prepares his hopefully very successful future at this club. So, yeah, absolutely great, great news. Imagine we would have to buy this boy now. So, thank God we only had to give him a new contract.
And as you prepare to kick off the new season, how much are you as a group all looking forward to being back in front of, well, nearly full stadium and back in front of fans?
Yeah, we got a little sense of obviously how it is with fans again last Sunday and Monday. So it was absolutely great and changed the whole game. The little difference is now that we obviously play at Norwich and not at Anfield, and they will be exactly as desperate as our people were before they went back to Anfield. So we are better ready for a proper fight there. That's what we are preparing for all the time now, because the competition starts and the pre-season friendlies are over, so it's nice to try a few things to test here and there, but now all the other stuff is there again. We play for points, we play for our supporters, obviously for fulfilling expectations, dreams, whatever. So that is the difference, but we had the longest preseason for a while, especially the longest preseason with a big squad together. A lot of players were involved in a full preseason. Some came back at least early enough, some came back a little bit later. Now they're all here, and it's a good situation, and that's what you want at the end of a preseason, that you have a few choices to make and then to start the season with the first game. And we know the intensity will now be completely different, and we think at the moment we are ready for it, but we have to prove that on Saturday.
Okay, thank you, Vinny. Two for Steve Wyeth, and then we'll go to Juliet Farrington from the BBC.
Hello there, Jürgen. Having said you've had that pre-season to work with your players, and considering all the injury problems you had last season, how close are you to having the team you want to select for the first game of the campaign?
Oh, they're all here, and all our players are here in the moment, and that means we have to make selection. But of course, for example, Hendo and Thiago started late to train, so their pre-season, if you want, started last week, and they need it because we don't prepare for one game, we prepare for a full season with a lot of games, with the most intense league in the world. So apart from that, all the others trained at least 2 weeks, and some of them have said trained 5 weeks, so I have exactly the situation I want to have. I hope it stays like this, that we have no major injuries apart from Robbo, obviously, who is not available for the weekend, and Curtis, but he is fit again. It's just a protocol, and we of course respect that, and so that's it, and that's now the situation, a good situation, but still I have to make some decisions.
And you mentioned there the intensity of the Premier League. Considering that some of your rivals have gone out and really invested heavily this summer, are you expecting that the fight for the Premier League title to be even more intense than ever this time around?
I don't know if that could be. Is that possible? So, last year, obviously, City was... the gap was pretty big. The year before with us, the gap was pretty big. I'm not sure if it can get even more intense for all the rest. So we will see. Yeah, Chelsea obviously is not hiding their ambitions, and Man United isn't. City isn't. We don't want to hide our expectations because our ambitions, because we want to fight for everything. But whatever will happen in the season, we don't know now. But in this moment, yeah, it will be a massive fight. And I mentioned only these four, but it will not be only these four. Looks like Leicester made really good business again. Arsenal is trying, Tottenham is obviously trying really hard, and there are so many teams. West Ham played the best season for a long, long time last year. They didn't get worse over the summer, so they are, it will be an interesting league again, very, very interesting. So let's see how it starts, and then we can talk about that, and then let's make the next step.
Plenty of interest in Arsenal. No problem, Steve. We'll go Juliet Farrington, then Ian from Saltsport. Juliet, for one.
Hey Jürgen, good to see you again. After the brilliant pre-season that you would have appeared to have had with that month away, you know, just training and working in that your own little bubble that you had, are you as excited, and you talk about playing for the fans with their expectations and dreams, are you as excited as the fans are for this season?
Definitely. We had exactly the same time we were waiting exactly for the same amount of time, so I had 4 weeks preseason training, which is absolutely great, or 5 weeks, which is absolutely great, and I love that, and it's the best part of the season actually, because you can work on all the things you want to see later in the season, and it was good, but unfortunately, I'm pretty sure that the preseason of Norwich or the other teams was not bad as well, so they will be really good prepared as well, so that's good. So the most important thing is that you are ready for the competition then, and this is a completely different intensity to preseason games, obviously, which we have now again in the Premier League. Everything together, missing a chance in a preseason friendly, it's not a problem. It's always easy to explain. We had a hard session before yesterday and stuff like this. Now we should be rested. I don't expect 100%. I expect 100, the available 100% tomorrow. That means I want us to develop during the season to reach a specific point, our absolute peak, and keep that then going for the full season. But I expect the available 100% for tomorrow, and that's a lot. So, and that's what we have to show. And then we have to be ready for all these pressure situations that you score, or they score, and you have to react and all this kind of stuff. And that's something you can talk about in preseason, what we did, but then there's a difference, still a difference between the reality and what we were talking about before. So how do we react in stress situations? That's all interesting, and I'm really excited about that. That's starting now again, because we all want to play proper competitive games. Preseason is important, but we all prepare only for the league, and the league starts now, and it's very exciting.
Thank you, Juliet. We'll go to Ian for TalkSport, and then to Carl Woodward from BBC Merseyside.
Hi Jürgen, how are you?
Good, thank you.
Jürgen, were you surprised that clubs like Manchester City spent £100 million on one player this summer? That obviously we saw Manchester United spend over £100 million on a couple of players, and that Chelsea spent nearly £100 million on a striker, considering we've just come through a pandemic. And how important is this to get a good start to the season as well?
February 2020, when the pandemic started, and nobody knew how long it will be, and on. I was hoping, obviously, that it's over in a month, in 2 months, whatever. Now we are so much smarter, we know so much more about it, and it's still difficult time. So it was for everybody, it was for football clubs as well, obviously, for different reasons, and that's probably the reason why you asked me if I'm surprised. No, because these clubs don't depend on this kind of things, I think. It's just not. Yeah, we all know the situation of Chelsea, and we all know the situation of City, and we all know the situation of PSG, for example. What United is doing, I don't know exactly how they do it, but we have obviously our way to do it, and that's what was always the same since I'm in. It was always the same. We can spend, and we are allowed to spend the money we earn. That's what we always did. So this year we spent already before we earned money with Ibu Konate, because after last season it was obviously clear we cannot take any risk in this position at all, and that's it. And that's our situation, and it's not about me being surprised. I'm never surprised about the financial power of Chelsea or City or United. I'm long enough in the country to know that they always find a solution to do these kind of things, and for us it's our way. So we keep the team together. That's an important part of business as well. I know it's not that as exciting as it is with signing new players for the outside world, but it looks like always this, the summer is always the same. People think if you don't sign, you don't work. That's not the case. We are constantly thinking about the presence. The present and the future. So short term and long term, what do we have to do? What can we do? How has the team to look this year? How will it look next year? And all this kind of stuff. And that's the situation. So maybe not the most exciting, but if you are a real Liverpool fan, you are really happy about the news the club delivered in the last few weeks. So signing Alisson Becker until I don't know when. The same with Trent Alexander-Arnold, Fabinho. Who else? Virgil. Yeah, obviously only recently. So, and others will follow. So that's great. That's absolutely great news. But it's just not as spectacular out there, obviously, seen as it was. But if other teams wanted to sign these players, they would have to pay a lot of money, and we have them already. So that's good. So now we have a really good squad together. We should be in a better situation than we were last year. So let's try to build on that, what we achieved last year, and let's see where we will end up.
And Ian also asked, is a good start important?
Sorry?
Is a good start important as opposed to is a bad start important?
Yeah. A good start is important, but we wouldn't stop if we couldn't start well. So that's the case. But yeah, I love to win the first game, but I think it would be disrespectful to talk about these kind of things before we face Norwich even. So we have to go there. We will do that this afternoon to have a nice sleep overnight, play there tomorrow afternoon. And I know how good they are, and I know how great a job Stanley Farke is doing there. They obviously gave him, for a situation, for a club of like Norwich, is incredible trust in him, a new four-year contract, which is absolutely great. So they believe there in his work and the project. And you can see that they lost good players, or one at least, what I know about, but their problems did sensational business. Billy Gilmore is probably obviously one of the biggest Scottish talent for the last 50 years. Bring him in on loan. Then Rashica, I know from the Bundesliga. Sargent, I know from the Bundesliga. So two really good, exciting strikers, offensive players. So, lost Bundia, yes, but the replacements they found. Now the little Greek boy who came in last week. So, good business. So exciting what they are doing, and we have to be absolutely spot on to have a good start. And if we had a good start, then we can talk about that.
Okay, we're going to order Carl Woodward and from Merseyside, and then we'll go to Carl Markham from Press Association. Carl.
Hi Jürgen.
Hi Carl.
Just reflecting on the end of last season, the top four looked like it was getting away from you until you made that brilliant dash to the line. So how much a boost did that give to you and the players, and what can you take from that going into the new campaign?
Oh, absolutely. We had a lot. This kind of never give up. And I would like to say that I had 10 games before the end of the season, and I thought, oh, come on, we can do that still and stuff like this. It wasn't like that. I didn't think about it. That helped. I just thought, come on, let's win the next game. Let's see where we end up. And in the end, that's what helped. So we just stayed in a situation. Yes, last 2-3 games, we knew it's kind of in our own hands again, and can pressure up again. We came through it. We for us, the third place last year was really not far off the other positions in the 2 years before in the league, to be honest, and was really special with all the problems we had. We found in the end a way how to win football games, and now that's a very important message, obviously, because there's one way how you play when you are at your absolute best. That's obviously great to watch and what you want to see, and makes winning football games more likely. But then there is another way to win football games when you are not at your best, when you have to solve problems. We need a little bit to find this way exactly how we can do it. It's not that it's rocket science and we don't know how it works, but we need it a little bit to get used to this slightly different approach. And but we found it early enough. Finished the situation, it was obviously absolutely sensational feeling, and yes, that will help us because it is another experience we made together, and how all experiences, when you get through them, then you are smarter than before.
Okay. Carl, one question if that's okay, so we've got two more to come after you, then a breakout. Carl Markham.
No problem. Hi again.
Hi.
Hi. I'm sure this won't bother Virgil, but there's so much expectation placed on his return. I'm just wondering if that's right. That's a fair thing to assume.
It's virtual. So, and Virgil was out for a long time, is now training with the team for 3.5 weeks, which is absolutely great. Played minutes in different games, played long, could have played last game, I'm pretty sure, could have played 90 minutes. We just didn't try to do it. And so he's in good shape and he's an important player for us. So I'm really happy with the situation.
And then Neil and James to finish. Sorry, we are busy today. And then we go to the breakout. Neil.
Hi Jürgen, you okay?
Hi Neil, yeah.
Yeah, just want to ask about Harvey Elliott. I mean, he made a big impression in pre-season. Last season, he went out on loan quite late in the window. Would you say that he's moved past that situation now and he's made himself part of the first team squad for this season?
That's the plan. That's the plan. He showed up in an exceptional way. He was not the only one, but of course Harvey's only 18, so it might be really exceptional. The only problem Harvey has, we don't treat him like an 18-year-old boy, at least not in training sessions and on the pitch, because it's just his football is pretty mature in a lot of moments. Off the pitch, he's much more a kid than on the pitch. And so that's really exciting. Yes, we are happy about that. He brings, like all our midfielders, they're all different, and it brings different dimension into the game, which is good. His overview is great. Dribbling, top, passing, range, really good, and a lot of things. So it's really interesting. So he played at top preseason, but so did Kate Gordon. He's only 16. That's the situation. If you don't have these spaces in the squad, you block these boys, and we have to keep these spaces open for these exceptional talents. That's what we try. It's not always possible, and it doesn't mean it will happen next week, next month, next year. It's just we need to show that we are a club who gives the opportunity to these kind of boys and to these kind of talents, and that's what we want to show. And that's why it was really, really good preseason so far for him. And let's see how we can use that.
Thank you, Neil. And before we go to the embargo section, just a reminder for those who are putting their hands up, we have been on for a while, so I can't take everybody's going to put their hand up in it, but if you want to do so now, I'll try to admit you. James, to finish the open section.
Hi, Jürgen. Just in terms of Gini Wijnaldum, obviously he left the club this summer. He hasn't been directly replaced in terms of the business you've done so far. Is that down to finances? Is that because you genuinely do see solutions within the squad, because obviously he was such a key part of your unit?
He was absolutely. He was the most consistently available player, at least, and he was. And I think you don't have to hide the relationship I had with Gini and how much I loved his way of play, how reliable he was as a player, and all this kind of stuff. So, but he's not here anymore, and so now you tell me if you would sign a midfielder, and if then tell me the name, and I think about it. That would be really interesting. No, just to say, we can count our midfielders, and then you tell me we need to replace Gini Wijnaldum. So we have now, so far, Henderson and Thiago had not really been involved in the preseason. Maybe a few days now, let me say nearly a week. We played quite a few games with Milner, Naby Keita and Harvey. So we have another midfield which played now the second game, I think, that was Oxley, Fabinho, Curtis Jones. Curtis is another player who can and will make the next step, and he's exceptional talent. So, yeah, I think these are the pure midfielders. I for sure forgot somebody, which would not be nice. But as it's already only the numbers and different profiles of players and stuff like this, and now you tell me which player we need. Just, I'm really interested, not angry, not annoyed, not at all. I'm really interested. Which kind of player would you like to sign? What should the player have we should sign? So should he score more goals than Gini? Should he defend better than Fab? Should he be more creative than Naby, Curtis, Ox, Harvey? What do you want?
Well, I think a lot of fans would say there's been a lack of goals from midfield. Maybe that would be one element that people would say that it could be improved.
Yeah. So he should score more goals, yeah? Okay. Makes sense. I don't know which midfielder it is then who scores more goals from that position, then the boys of us. We never said we don't have to improve. We have to improve, but we have to score more goals from midfield positions. You have to create the situations for that. So it's not that you just can save in a midfielder. If a midfielder has to play for us in the way we play, then it's not that easy that he's constantly in goal scoring situations. So they have to do different jobs. We have a specific setup of our team. You see where our fullbacks are usually in attacking moments. You see who's in the box, who's there. We could have scored more goals, definitely yes. It's not about having a different player for that. It's about different positioning in that situation, and our boys can do that as well. I really understand that, and I'm not a sixth year here, and I think pretty much apart from the year when we signed Ali and Virch, it was always the same. It looks always we don't sign enough, we don't do enough, and this kind of stuff. But we were constantly on improving the team, and one part of it is signing new players. But the most important thing, and I actually think our fans appreciate that as well, is having a group together who is fun to watch, who is exciting to watch, who is fighting together, who creates a specific, who is definitely 100% committed to the club and to the values of the club and all this kind of stuff. And we have that. So in that loud, let's fight with all we have. And whatever happens until the end of the preseason, we will see. But we cannot just add on players to this squad and say, "Look, and now let's have a look how that works," because you have to deal with the squad the whole year. And that's why if somebody wants to leave or leaves or stuff like this, then we have to think, do we have to replace it or not? With Chini, it's like that, but we have, if you want, two players who are not new but can make the next step with Harvey and Curtis, and Nabi can make the next step. Had a full preseason, but it's exceptional preseason, so he can make the next step. We cannot just ignore that, and he is an outstanding player which everybody wants to sign probably, and these kind of things. That's our situation, and we cannot compare. I said it before, we cannot compare to the other clubs. They obviously don't have any limits. We have limits, but we were quite successful even with having limits in the last few years, and that's what we should try again, and not using it as an excuse. If we will not win a game, we say then it was because we didn't sign him or him. That will not be the case. We want to use our sources, and that's passion and a good way and desire and a clear plan and all this kind of stuff, and direction, flexibility, all this kind of stuff. That's our football. That's what we want to use. And then let's see which is the right way. We cannot spend money we don't have. So we cannot. Maybe others can't, but we can't. So that's it. That's my information.
Thank you, James.